And it fits the description, right? You're the Roadrunner.
That's what they call me, the Roadrunner.
Well, let's go back and talk about Motown in a couple of minutes, but let's start from the beginning, right? I read there are a couple of biographies, little sketches of you that I read, and they don't agree where you were born. I mean, some people say you were born in Blytheville, Arkansas.
Yeah, that's where I supposed to be.
Yeah,
born.
I mean, you grew up in Indiana. One said you were born in Indiana, but that's not true. You were born in...
No. I wasn't born in Indiana. I was born in Blytheville, Arkansas. That's what they told me.
Right.
But, you know, and so I moved from there to Chicago and with an aunt. And I was raised around Chicago for a while, and I moved over to Indiana.
South Bend.
Right. Yeah, and that's where I picked up, started playing music and picked up, you know, the music feel. And from there on, I ended up in Detroit and started recording.
You see, Junior Walker is not your real name either.
Well, what's my real name then?
You want me to tell you?
Well, let's keep it a secret.
See, it's up to you. I mean, I got it written down here, but I won't tell anybody. Because, see, I'm not telling them my real name, so I figured that if I don't do that, then I shouldn't tell them your real name either.
Right. Don't tell them my real name. Just tell them Roadrunner.
That makes sense, but your son who plays drums, they don't call him Junior Walker Jr.
No, they don't call. They call him the Weasel.
Oh,
but
is it in your son? They call the Weasel.
That's right.
That's your son, the drummer. I thought I didn't know that.
Yeah, supposed to be my son.
Oh, well, you didn't tell me that. You just said your drummer. I mean, I know that your son had played drums with you before, but I didn't know you have him on the road with you now.
Oh yeah, he goes on the road occasionally.
So yeah. That's the Weasel.
That's the Weasel.
All right. Weasel Walker.
Well, I guess you could call him that.
And the All-Stars. But you started playing in high school. I actually played piano before you started playing saxophone, right? You were about 9 years
yeah,
old.
Yeah, I messed around with it a little bit, and I picked up guitar. You know, I messed around with both of them a little bit. And I fancied the horn. I kind of liked it. I don't know. I just picked it up and started trying to blow it. And right off, I could blow it without any help from anyone, you know. And so I was blowing another fella's horn. He taking it away from me. Then my uncle gave me one that he, you know, he always tried to blow, and he gave me a horn. And that started me out. And then my mother, well, the horn he gave me wasn't all that good. So my mother taking that and traded it in, and she bought me my first Selma. And that's the one that made all the hits.
Was there any horn player who inspired you that you heard maybe on the radio or on records, and you decided, I want to play like him, or I want to play the horn?
Oh, so, yeah, that's what...
Who was it?
Well, Boots Randolph, really? You know, when they come at that yakety-yak stuff.
That's strange. Yeah, why a horn player like that?
I don't know, he just...
He played country music, basically.
Yeah, but that one or two songs got to me. And then I listened to Eleanor Jacquet.
Right.
I listened to him a lot. And, you know, they call him Jug. I listened to Jug for a while.
Gene Ammons. Right.
And picked up on... I mostly listened to all of the, you know, the guys that was really playing at the time.
They used to have those tenor blowing sessions, right? Gene Ammons and Sonny Stitt.
Yeah, man. I was kind of digging them, and that's what got me off into it, you know.
They go on there and do four bars a piece, right? And they go back and forth and try to cut each other.
Oh, they blow. They blow the wild.
It's a cutting contest.
Right.
But why Boots Randolph? That whole yakety sax thing, wasn't that what King Curtis blowed on... Yakety
yeah,
yak.
He blowed it. I don't know if it was him, but I think Boots Randolph at the time was blowing this tune. And
I thought he got that from King Curtis, so I thought that
if he did or not, but that's where I heard it. And
you know, it's that ba da ba ba da ba ba da ba ba da ba ba da da ba 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 da. Remember
that? Yeah, all that stuff. And
that's the one
I heard it off the Coasters record.
Right. That's it.
Yeah, that's where it come from. And someone said it was Boots Randolph, and that inspired me a lot, and I started, you know, really wanting to play then.
But you heard all the jazz guys back in those days, all the people who were playing in the big bands. And...
Oh, yeah. You listened to Lionel Hampton, all them bad dudes.
That's where Illinois played, right? Illinois.
Yeah, there's some bad dudes. I used to sit and listen to them.
Do Flying Home? Or...
Oh, yeah. I used to listen to them. I learned, that's what I, one of the, about the first tunes I learned to play.
Flying Home.
Flying Home.
did you play along with the records? You trying to?
Yeah. What I did, I just I got a real good ear for, you know, music, and I just picked the boy's horn up one day, and it was playing, and I fished around and found the key and just played along with him, And the guy looked at me and said, "You've been playing before." I said, "No, not really." And he said, "Man, you blow that again." So I blowed it again.
Could you read it all back in that time?
Oh, no. You know, I didn't know about no reading, man. I was playing by ear.
You still play by ear, basically? Or?
Yeah. Well, yeah. When it really come down to it, I'd rather play by ear than try to read. I'd read it, and then I would put the reading, I would stop, and then go back and just play it, you know, by memory.
But you learned how to read a little bit.
Oh, yeah. I picked up reading a little bit. I can read pretty good, but I can listen to a tune and go away and just pick my horn up and play it.
That's the way to do it.
That's the only way I can do it.
I'll tell you a story. I was a kid. I played the piano for 1 year, mm-hmm. right? And they had me these scales. You got to play these little finger exercises that they make you play.
Yeah.
And the teacher would yell at me and say, "No, man, you don't play it like that. And this is how you play it." And he'd play it, and I'd come back and listen to it, and I'd play it back by ear. And about a month, the teacher figured out that what I was doing, that I was playing it by ear, and I wasn't right. learning my exit. He dropped me.
That's
the end of my piano career, man. I had a good ear, but I couldn't read them finger exercises.
Well, he should have let you went on, you know, the way you was doing, because you probably would have gotten better. See, mm-hmm. because by your ear is stronger anyway. Because whatever they teach you playing by music and something like that, that's just to get your ear trained to the keys and where everything is. That's what the notes and the scales is for. They're not just, you know, you're just supposed to read them and know them. They train your ear a lot, too, you know, from where your chords and things. It's to learn your chords and scales and learn the board. But when you're playing the scales and things, it trains your ear also to know where the notes and things are.
That's true. When you go out there and improvise, you got to have it in your head there. You got to have some of it in your head. You got to hear them chord changes. It's not enough just to read them.
Right. You can't read them then.
That's right.
So when they throw something like that, and if you're going to improvise and play solos and things, well, then you can't read it, because, you know, they just can't sit down and write you out a solo. They can, but you wouldn't want to play it that way.
Well, you were in a couple of high school bands, right? One called the Jumping Jacks.
Right. We had a little thing going called the Jumping Jacks, and what happened, why it broke up, the boy that was with us, he had to go off to the Army. And then we picked up another boy. It was Bill Sticks Nix, and we put the band up under his name, and then he got drafted. And so then we went back, and they said, "Well, instead of going back to the Jumping Jacks, we're going to name it after you." I said, "What you mean?" Junior Walker. So they named the band
after me. What kind of tunes were you playing back in the days of Sticks Nix or the Jumping Jacks? What were they doing?
Oh, the tunes?
What kind of material?
We was playing all the latest tunes that they had out at that time.
You were playing the juke joints in the bars and...
Oh, yeah, that's the kind Blueberry Hill, I found my thrill. We was doing all those.
Did you try to sound like Lee Allen or Herb Hardesty? did you get that right after?
Well, we tried to sound like mostly everyone that had a record out.
So you basically imitated the records, right? It was other people's... But yeah. you had your own feeling to it, didn't
you? Yeah, but then... I started creating things from playing through the years, like in the Jumping Jacks and tunes like that. I started creating things then and started coming up with tunes of our own. And I was getting away from just playing other people's records then. And that's when I started moving out pretty good.
Yeah, you settled in Battle Creek, Michigan.
Yeah, we settled in Battle Creek, Michigan.
Home of the Box Tops, right? Where they have all them... Giveaways.
Sometimes you Kellogg's. Can go down there and they'll give you some cornflakes.
Send your box tops to Battle Creek, Michigan, right?
That's right. And go down and get you a few cornflakes and have a good time.
What were you doing in Battle Creek? Did you have session work there or bands? Or?
Well, I bought me a farm.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I got a big farm and I was mostly fooling around. You know, I like a farm anyway.
So music was just part-time back in those days. You had the farm and...
Oh, yeah, I build race cars and build, you know, taking old trucks and build them into, put motors in them and change motors and, you know, do all that kind of stuff. I do that, too.
Still do it?
Oh, yeah, I'm still doing it. Oh, yeah, I don't stop doing that, man. So enjoy that.
Gives you a break for the music, then.
Yeah, it relaxes you and gets you away from, you know, music and stuff all the time.
So were you doing session work back in those days before you had, you know, your band made it?
Yeah, I was doing some session work. I wasn't really heavy in it into, you know, session work then. I've helped the first record coming out went with was Harvey Fuqua.
Right, of the Moon Glows.
Right. And
they had Sincerely.
Well, yeah, they had quite a few.
Well, what was it? Sincerely, and the Ten Commandments of Love.
Right.
Thou shalt never love another. Remember that one?
Yeah, they had quite a few things. It was Anna Records. It was out of Detroit, and I did some work behind. I did some work behind some of his people's groups and things.
Was Anna Harvey's label, or was Anna one of Berry Gordy's? Wasn't Berry Gordy's sister or something?
That's Berry Gordy's sister. It was Anna. It was Anna's record company.
That's the one that Barrett Strong, the original Money, right? The one that Barrett Strong recorded for was on
right. It was on that label, yeah.
Right.
And so I think the Spinners was on there too.
Yeah.
Yeah, they was on there. They come out with That's What Little Girls Are Made For. Sugar and Spice and all those things, nice. And that was a big hit for him.
But Harvey Fuqua had his own label called Harvey, didn't he? That was
Yeah, he got one too. But that, I think Anna's record was doing a little better. But then they folded up. They really didn't get over too good. And then they joined up with Motown.
Was it Harvey who signed you originally? Where did he hear?
Yeah, he really.
Where did he hear that Junior Walker?
Well,
and the
what happened? He didn't hear. Johnny Bristol brought come and got me. I was in a little club playing. Johnny and Jack came in, and Johnny said, "I think you need to be recording." I said, "Recording?" I didn't really know what recording was. And he said, "Yeah, cutting records." I said, "Oh, yeah, cutting records." He said, "Yeah." I said, "Is there any money in it?" He said, "Why, sure, man. There's a whole lot of money in that, you know." I said, "Well, then when you want to take me to, you know, take me wherever I have to go." So he told me, after Sunday night, he said, "Monday, we was playing in Battle Creek." He said, "Monday, you come back up here and I take you, you know, to a record company." And so I stayed over all night. I just sat in the car. We sat in the car and talked about it, and we slept in the car. And the next morning, he came by. He's where we were supposed to meet, and he taking me to Harvey. And that, we taking the band up there, and we recorded. First, he walked around and listened to us. He said, "Well, they really a little, you know, they too good, you know." And then Harvey said, "Wait a minute. Make it a little raggedy. Can you make it a little raggedy?" I said, "Yeah, we can make it any kind of way you want it."
You mean you were too sweet? You were too...
I don't know. We was too tight.
Oh.
And so then he said, "Well, I'm going to record you." I said, "Okay." So he said, "What you got?" We cut a tune called... first tune we cut was Monkey Jump. No, we cut Twist Like a Wanna, Satan's Blues.
What year was this?
Oh, that was back in 60s.
This was the early 60s, right?
61, 62, oh, okay. Somewhere yep. In there, way back. And then we cut those two records, and he put them out. And then we cut another record, and we cut Monkey Jump. And then we cut Cleo's Mood. And that hit for him. It hit real big. But then he just didn't have the money to back the record, see? The record was a little bit too heavy for him. And that's about the time he folded.
And this was the time that Berry Gordy came in.
Right. He came in. I went to Mr. Gordy, and we sat down and talked about it. And he said, "Well, you want to sign a contract?" I said, "That's right. I'm here to record." And so he said, "Well, sign that contract there." I signed the contract. And he said, "When you get ready to record, he said, "Call me and come on in." I said, "Okay." And that's the way it was done.
Now, he had Berry Gordy had a strange background. There was a story which supposedly was not true, that he had worked on the assembly line and he went on to become a big record company president. But that wasn't quite true, because he had a lot of experience in recording before. Included Marv Johnson, right? He got what it takes. And he even wrote tunes for Jackie Wilson.
Right.
He wrote Reed Petit. Yeah. That's one of Berry Gordy's tunes.
Mm-hmm.
Reed Petit.
Yeah.
And what was it? There's another
He did have something to do with Jackie Wilson, too. Now that you mention it, because
I think Higher and Higher is a Berry Gordy tune also.
Mm-hmm. He did. He was doing a lot of things now. But I think he did come off of that assembly line and get into it. Because
well, at one point he was.
I figured he probably figured that he could do it then, you know, after he probably was doing some good things into it. And then I guess he looked at it in a way that he said, "I think I can do this now." Probably he figured he could really get into it, and he came on off into it then, and it really paid off. You know, it got big then, because when I called him, I said, "Well, I got a tune to cut." He said, "What is it?" "Monkey Jump." He said, "Oh, the Monkey Jumping. Okay, come on." So I recorded that, and it did fairly well. And then I called him and told him I had Shotgun. He laughed. Oh, he fell out laughing. He said, but it sounds good. The word sounds good. I said, okay. He said, come in and cut it. I went in and cut Shotgun. And that did it.
This was 1965, right?
Right around 64, coming out in the 65.
Came out just about beginning of 1965.
That was it.
I'll tell you what. Let's listen to Shotgun. We'll come back and talk some more, okay? It's exactly 7 o'clock. We're WHFS in Bethesda, Maryland, the 102.3. I'm Weasel. We're talking to Junior Walker, who's playing at Desperados in Georgetown tonight. And we'll listen to Shotgun. Come right back.
Yeah, this is it. Shotgun is the record.
Because back in those days, they had Norman Whitfield producing tunes and Holland Dozier and Holland.
Oh, yeah. Tunes, but, yeah, they had everybody.
But that one, that Berry Gordy himself produced that one.
Yeah, he helped me with that record. He came in, he said, it sounds good. He said, it sounds good.
Did he have that magic in the studio?
Oh, yeah. At that time, he was really off into the music field. He really had his mind set on the music field then.
Did he take charge of the session? Did you do what he said, or did he give you some leeway, some freedom?
Well, they give you some leeways, and then he wouldn't just take over because I already had things kind of set up. He would tell you what to do, and then he said, you know, do this and do that. And, he wouldn't more or less lead you in the right way. And then he would kind of get back out of your way. He wouldn't get in it and just say, well, do this, do that. And then he would, most people would do that. Then it'd get boring, you know. And it's like someone just driving you. So he wouldn't do that. See, he would just say, well, I think you should do this and I think you should do that. And then he would back out the way and say, well, try it and see if I'm right.
And was he right usually? Did it work?
Oh, yeah, he was right. You know the father was right. He wouldn't let on. He said, well, I was pretty close. And then he would leave, you know. But he wouldn't say, yeah, I was right. He'd take the credit or nothing. He wouldn't take the credit or nothing like that.
Now, a lot of your records, aside from your exquisite horn playing, which we all know about, is the bass lines on those tunes. Like, especially, we're going to play Shake and Finger Pop in a minute, but that one in Shotgun's got that boom, 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 boom.
Oh, yeah.
Which is that steady bass line, which made a lot of the tunes. Did you come up with that? Is it your band that... You were playing like that before?
We was playing. We was playing it. But he had Jameson at that time. You know Jameson?
Yeah.
And Mr. Gardy put Jameson on that. He said, he brought him in and said, I want you to get on this project. He knew who to go get when he would really want something to get over. And he knew who was in the studios and who was around the record company that could do different things that he would want. And when we come up with these tunes, he went and got Jameson and said, I think you can do this here. I want you on this project. And let me know how it come out. And then he would leave.
Were these charted? Were they written out beforehand? Or did Jameson come in the studio and just kind of create what he did?
Well, he kind of created some of the
things. So wasn't written out beforehand.
No,
this guy got in the studio and you jammed and
oh, no. See, when you write, like I told you, when you write a tune out, it really doesn't get played as well because you're going by those lines. But Mr. Gardy kind of left it up to him. He said, I want you on this thing because I know you know what to do. And then he would just say, well, let me know how it come out, and then he would leave.
How long would you work on a tune like that? Did you get it on the first or second take, or would you sit there for hours and just...
No, we cut that. It was two takes.
Really?
I think the first take was the one that did it.
And it was done live in the studio? No overdubbing, right?
No overdubbing. We did it live in the studio. Harvey Fuker was there. My drummer couldn't do the parts I gave him. And Mr. Harvey Fuker, he said, I know what you want. And he called in the studio drummer and put him on there. And then he told him how to make the breaks and everything. And we run it down the first time. And it was so good. They said, well, run it down again.
Just to be from insurance.
Yeah, and we run it. We did it twice. We cut it twice. The first take we take, and that's the one you hear now.
So you'd go in there, you'd call a tempo, you call a key, right? And you do it about that, and you...
That was it.
And you had it in the head, and you just went...
We knocked it right on out.
Did you experiment with tempos at all? Did you try to maybe take a...
No, we didn't. We didn't. No.
You had to groove right from the beginning. You didn't.
Right from the beginning, I played it, and I...
Were most of the tunes done that way?
Most of all of my tunes is mostly that way.
You didn't think that, well, let's try a little bit faster.
No.
You had it all...
I know it's just about how fast I want to play it. So I just stomped it off, and we
just
went
in. And that was it.
Yeah, we went right on into it.
That's amazing. You just played it back, and sounds good, and you used it.
Well, we played it back, and then they said, well, it's real good, but let's see if we can get one more. And we just cut it the same way. And I think Mr. Garden Brian said, that first take, that's it. So we're going with the first take.
It's strange.
Then he'd ask, do anyone have any objections? And, everyone said, no, they all kind of said that first one is kind of strong. And he said, well, I'll tell you what you do to make yourself satisfied. Play the first one, then play the second one. Mm-hmm. And then he said, let me know. And he told me, now you go in and sign the papers for the record and everything. And he left.
It's strange that with all this planning that Barry supposedly had with this the Sound of Young America Motown, that most of the records were done. Not only yours, but other artists also were done one or two takes, and they were out in the street in the record stores and on the radio in 3 days.
Yeah.
He could do it that way.
He was doing it that way at the time because he was more off into it. And he had his head directed in hits. And he wanted hits, and that's what he was getting.
Nowadays, people sit in the studio and they remix again for months at a time, right? Now,
take a whole year to cut an album.
But he could have a record. He could have the tune written. He could have it produced. He could have it played and have it pressed up on a record, and on the radio, and in the stores in 3 days.
That's right.
And he did that.
I tell you one time a funny story. We was recording, and they didn't have all the stuff to, to hide the drums and to keep the sounds from going around. And the music, we was recording, Put On Your Wig Woman, We're Going Out and Shaking Finger right. Pop. And one of the RA men said, wait, we can't get him like that because it's sounding good, but we can't get him like that, see? And Mr. Garter said, get him like that because I'm paying you to get him like that. And said, leave it alone and go get him just like he's doing it. And they said, all right, Mr. Garter. And then they recorded us just the way we were set up because it was just hidden. They didn't hide the drums and do nothing, and we recorded that record just like that.
Now, we're talking about the rhythm section, or basically the house band. It was the Earl Van Dyke band, wasn't it? It was. They were basically his...
Mostly my band did recording. Earl Van Dyke's them helped me with a lot of things, but it wasn't a whole band.
But you used some of his musicians, basically.
Oh, we used some of them sometime. But most of the tunes that you heard back then, it was the organ player, my guitar player, and the drummer. And that's mostly what you heard. And then they would put Jameson on later on.
He would overdub then.
Yeah, he'd overdub Jameson.
So they got that heavy bass sound.
Yeah, they get that bass thing then. Because most of the we played by was the organ bass.
Well, a lot of people have commented on the distinctive Motown sound, that he had a certain kind of way of mixing. He had a lot of snare drum, a lot of cymbals were on the record. And
I don't know. In this little house where we was recording, it was just a little old house. And it just had such a tremendous sound that I haven't been able to find that sound. I've been all over. Mm-hmm. Even I've recorded in L.A. and I've recorded all over. And I haven't found that sound yet. And I've been all over the country recording.
It's strange because a lot of people said that Barry would mix his records to sound good on a car radio, on a little speaker. You know, nowadays we've got these...
Sometimes he did do that. But that sound he had, I think it come from that building.
You think that was it?
Yep. He arranged that thing and set it up. And it probably at the time he was doing it, he didn't know what he was doing itself.
Because, it's true. When I was a younger, let's put it that way, listening to your records back in 1965 or 66, and I would hear most of them on the car radio, on the AM Top 40 stations, and I went out and I bought your singles, and I bought the Temptation singles and the Supreme singles. I couldn't afford the albums. And I could, I was just a boy, right? I didn't have any money then. I'd go out and buy the singles and play them and hear them on the car radio. You know, it wasn't until just about 4 or 5 years ago when these, you see these records here, these anthology series of your greatest hits. They had one for every, all the Motown artists. It wasn't until then that I had actually heard these things in stereo. And I was always used to hearing them on the car radio, and all of a sudden I put them on, playing them on the radio here and there. This is huge stereo, this huge production, which sounds amazing.
Yeah, it's funny how they got that sound out of a four, I don't know if it was a 4 or 8 track. It wasn't no big tracks then. Wasn't a whole lot
It was only a 4 or 8 track then, really.
Yeah, that was it. And now they got 16, 25, all kind of 24 tracks, but it didn't sound no better than it did then to me.
So it was basically the producers, the Berry Gordys, the Norman Whitfield, and yourself, your ear that,
yeah,
that was
your
responsible
ear really
for
helps
this.
You. And most of those guys back in, I learned a lot from them. They're like, you know, they taught me a lot. Norman Whitfield, he was real strong in those days. You know,
you're still doing some work for him.
Oh, he's still, yeah, we're still recording. He's strong now, but I think he was a little bit heavy then. He's still heavy. He haven't gotten, you know, weaker.
Definitely. This is a tune called Shake and Finger Pop. It came about 6 months later than Shotgun, right?
Right.
And there are a lot of bands today that are still doing versions of this tune. They're imitating it.
Really?
Yeah, this tune, definitely.
Oh,
as a matter of fact, maybe I'll play you a couple in a few minutes, but let's listen to the original version. This is Shake and Finger Pop, and this is Junior Walker and the All-Stars. How about the classic R&B instrumentals?
Oh, yeah. I listen to a lot of them. I learned to play music with them.
The Red Price Sox.
Oh, yeah. I learned to blow a lot of their records.
I mean, Honky Tonk by Bill Donka. These were
Well, I know Honky Tonk, too.
Back in those days, I mean, there were a lot of rock and roll or R&B instrumentals, but back in the 60s when you were doing this, there wasn't a whole lot.
No, it wasn't quite a...
there was that Memphis sound happening and, you know...
Yeah, they had the Memphis sound. But
back then, but that was kind of an ensemble
blowing,
sound. That was a...
Like I was blowing.
Right, that was an ensemble sound, but it really, you know, not the jump sax instrumental was really wasn't happening back in those days. And you were kind of bringing it back.
Yeah, we brought it back into what was going on.
The only other person I think that did something like that was Jimmy Castor.
He was good.
He was similar.
King Curtis came in. He was blowing.
Yeah, but he'd done that before. He had joined this Memphis movement.
Right.
And he was a session man. He played all the Atlantic stuff, all the Coasters and the Drifters records back in those days. But it was just you, and I think you maybe had an influence on Jimmy Castor because he came a little bit later.
Probably did.
And I think he's still doing some stuff like that. He's a Texas boy, isn't he? So was King Curtis.
I didn't know King Curtis was from Texas.
So was Illinois. I mean, there's a whole line of Texas tenor players going back from Illinois, Chiquette, onward to Jimmy Castor and King Curtis.
He come from there, too.
Yeah.
You're telling me something now that I didn't know, see? I just only knew him by the records and things. I didn't know he'd come from different places like that, Texas and, you know, around.
But I think you had a profound influence on...
I probably did. A lot of people admired what I was doing at that time.
And I think you were carrying on the tradition of all those tenor players who used to lie on their back and walk the bar and just screech and honk.
Yeah. Have a good time. That's it.
Yep.
That's what it's all about.
What kind of places were you playing when you started to make it big? I mean,
little small places.
The Supremes and the Tops and the Temptations, they were all playing. They're playing Las Vegas. They're playing supper clubs. But they never tried to do that to you, did they? They never tried to groom you to be as a supper club act. They just let you loose.
Yeah, they just let me go the way I was going. And I don't know. He didn't really push me into nothing, try to guide me into things that, you know, would probably be...
He did to other people, other acts, didn't he?
Well, some of those, you know, he could push him into things. But I guess he would feel it would make it unpleasant for me, see? And so he just let me blow. He just said, let him go. When he'd walk in the studio, they said, well, Mr. Gardner, there was somebody would write a tune, and they would write the tune out, and he said, well, he can read, but... I let him read it, and then let him memorize it, and let him blow it the way he want to blow it. And he would get an argument from one or two of them, you know. Well, I think, and he said, well, I don't think. Let the man blow the way he feel he want to blow it. And then whenever I would do a tune of someone's, I would just blow it. And when I get through with it, they said, yeah, it's better than I wrote it. So it would end up, it would come out
Who was doing all the singing on these sessions?
Mostly me.
Mostly you. Any backup singers? Or?
Well, they would put girls and some of the Supremes and, you know, different ones around the company would come in and sing. Gladys Knight was on one of my records, too. I think one or two records she was on. She helped wrote it and sang it.
Did you in turn play on other the Motown artist sessions? Did he call you in?
Sometime he would call me in and put me on something.
But can you remember anything that you played behind?
Not at this time, not at this moment.
But there were.
Yeah, I did some things on some different things occasionally. But he mostly kept me to myself. You know, he mostly kept me off. And let me go the way I wanted to go.
I think he was afraid of you, right? He was afraid of your influence on it.
I don't know, not really. He just he knew what was best. That we said that he knew where I should be, and at the time I should be there. Instead of putting me into too many other things, he knew where he knew where he wanted me to be most of the time, and where he wanted me to be was them hits.
We talked about What Does It Take to Win Your Love. He finally got you to record that, a sweet tune. This is another one. This was done by a group called Guess Who? These Eyes.
Oh, no, These Eyes. Yeah, right. Johnny Bristol brought that to me. And
Why did they want you to record that?
Johnny did. He came to me and he said, I want you to do this tune. And I said, what tune you got, man? He said, now listen to Brits. I said, I'm listening. And of course, we had did What Does It Take. And he said, These Eyes. I said, I heard that thing. He said, yeah. He said, well, let's go to the studio. So we went to the studio. And I worked from, we cut about three or four tunes. We cut from 7 to about 12. And I stopped. I said, well, I'm tired now. And These Eyes was one of the tunes. Walking in the Night was one of the tunes. And he said, well, I got another tune for you. I said, what is it? He said, someday we'll be together. I said, so I turned the tune down. I turned it down. I said, no, I'm tired. I said, let's put that on the Supremes, man. He said, well, all right. And he put it on the Supremes.
And it worked.
Woo, did it work.
Definitely.
I said, well, that's the last time I turned the tune down.
Yeah, but you didn't look like Diana Ross anyway. I mean,
no, I didn't. No. And I guess it should have went that way. I guess it worked out the right way.
Well, I think you gotta leave, right? You're going to be playing real soon.
Oh, yeah. I got to go now and get ready.
Any favorites? What are of the tunes that you recorded, which were your favorites?
My favorite?
Yes, of your...
Well, you played one of them with Shotgun, and I liked it. What Does It Take?
Okay. Well, tell you what, we're going to play These Eyes, and then we'll play What Does It Take? I want to thank...